Good morning. I'm Judy Thielen.
And I'm Dan Thielen.
Welcome to the worship service at Fairmount Avenue United Methodist Church.
We hope you enjoy the service and have a great day. Take care.
Good morning. Welcome to Fairmount Avenue United Methodist Church on this beautiful Sunday in July. I'm Pastor Shauna, and I want to welcome you to worship this morning. As we worship together, I invite you to go on our website to faumc.net to find our worship guide, where you will find hymns and liturgies to assist in your worship this morning. We're so glad to be worshiping together. Let us begin.
Good morning. I'm Ashton Horsley, Director of Children's Ministries. And in this week's children's sermon, first we are going back in time, then we will go forward to the future. And all adventurers are invited to join me on this time-traveling children's sermon on Fairmount Avenue United Methodist Church's YouTube channel.
O holy God, open unto me light for my darkness, courage for my fear, hope for my despair. O loving God, open unto me wisdom for my confusion, forgiveness for my sins, love for my hate. O God of peace, open unto me peace for my turmoil, joy for my sorrow, strength for my weakness. O generous God, open my heart to receive all your gifts. Amen.
That Christ has regarded my hurt.
Let us continue our worship together, praying together. Holy God, we give thanks for this day. We give thanks for the ways in which you sustain us through your very creation. And God, we invite your spirit, your breath, to move among us as we gather in the places that we are, knowing that your spirit is not confined to a building, and that you continue to grow in us and to speak to us and call us into your work in this world from the places that we are. Today we breathe in your spirit. And we pray as your Son has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, holy be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen.
Ecclesiastes 3, verses 9 to 22. What do workers gain from their toil? I have seen the burden God has laid on the human race. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the human heart, yet no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. I know that there is nothing better for people than to be happy and do good while they live, that each of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all their toil. This is the gift of God. I know that everything God has done will endure forever. Nothing can be added to it and nothing taken away from it. God does it so that people will fear him. Whatever it is has already been, and what will be has already been before, and God will call the past to account. And I saw everything else under the sun. In the place of judgment, wickedness was there. In the place of justice, wickedness was there. I said to myself, God will bring into judgment both the righteous and the wicked. For there will be a time for every activity, a time to judge every deed. I also said to myself, as for humans, God will test them so that they may see that they will be like animals. Surely the fate of human beings is like that of the animals. The same fate awaits them both. As one dies, so dies the other. All have the same breath. Humans have no advantage over animals. Everything is meaningless. All go to the same place. All come from dust, and all to dust will return. Who knows if the human spirit rises upward and if the spirit of the animal goes down into the earth? So I saw that there is nothing better for a person than to enjoy their work, because that is their lot. For who can bring them to see what will happen after them?
Sitting in the morning sun, I'll be sitting when the evening comes, watching the ships roll in, then I watch them roll away again. I'm sitting on the dock of the bay, watching the tide roll away. Sitting on the dock of the bay, wasting time. I left my home in Georgia, headed for the Frisco Bay, 'cause I've had nothing to live for. Look like nothing's gonna come my way. I'm sitting on the dock of the bay, watching the tide roll away. Sitting on the dock of the bay, wasting time. Look like nothing's gonna change. Everything still remains the same. I can't.
So this morning, as we interact with our scripture and the text from Ecclesiastes, I want to invite you to just be present. Be present where you are. Maybe look at the space around you. If you have the opportunity to light a candle or just add a little comfort. So if you need to pause it, but take a moment to center yourself in your space. This morning, I'm fortunate enough to be sitting on a dock by the lake, reflecting on our sermon series and our song this morning, sitting on the dock of the bay. You know, this past week, we had the opportunity as a family to drive out one night. It was about 10 o'clock at night, and my husband and I pooled all of our kids in the car, and we drove out to find a country road and a dark spot where we might be able to see the comet Neowise. And I don't know if you had a chance to view it or look for it, but I found it to be pretty remarkable. Even if it didn't seem like a whole lot in the sky from the naked eye, at least we could see it. And there were things about it that really grabbed my imagination. One was that comet Neowise comes into our viewing distance about every 6,800 years. So I just want to take that for a minute. 6,800 years ago, people saw this comet from this planet. The comet is about 3 miles across in total. It's half made out of water and half made out of stardust, which is amazing. The water it contains would fill 13 million Olympic-sized pools. And its nucleus, this is what I love, its nucleus is made up of the material left over from the birth of our solar system. I mean, that's brilliant. It's like it's carrying the memory of creation as it streams through the universe. It's approximately 4.6 billion years old. Imagine that. That inside this thing that we can see in the sky, it's 4.6 billion years old, and it carries the hallmark and the markers of the very origins of our solar system. When I look to the sky and I look to the comet, I see God. I see glimpses of creation, of God, at work, and it inspires me. When I look at the lake, I see God at work. Our sermon series is titled Prophets of Rock, and the idea is that we are taking popular music and songs that contain lyrics that relate to scripture or directly quote scripture or talk about people from the scripture. And so today we have Otis Redding singing the classic Sitting on the Dock of the Bay. It was co-authored in 1967 by one of his friends that he often wrote with, Steve Cooper. And in it, Redding had just had this wonderful performance. And he was just feeling all of the success of his early career. And he was sitting. He was sitting on a dock in a bay in San Francisco, watching the ships come in and out. And that idea, that thought of the ships coming and going, the ships coming into the bay and out again, sat with him. And so it started to make him think about the bigger questions of life and what does it all mean, and the fact that this continual motion keeps happening. And Steve Cooper, his co-author, inserted lyrics reflecting on Otis's own experiences. It said that Otis didn't often write about his own experience, but Stephen Cooper would come back and in the writing and collaboration kind of give this bird's eye view of Otis's experiences. The reference in the song about the bay and this idea that looking at the San Francisco Bridge, at the time it was a center for despair in a lot of ways. It was a busy waterway, but often people would come to the San Francisco Bridge looking to find their own end of themselves. And so as Otis Redding was sitting and looking at this bridge and looking at the bay and the water roll away, the song asks the existential questions of life. What does it all mean? What is it all for? Why are we here? Where is their purpose? Where is their hope? Sitting on the dock of the bay, watching the tide roll away. Ecclesiastes is a book in scripture that asks these same kinds of questions and the same kinds of existential questions that Otis Redding was asking. The author of Ecclesiastes was also writing these very old questions. It reminds us that these questions are even primal to who we are as people. What does it all mean? What is the purpose? Where's their hope? If you remember, about a month ago, I preached on Ecclesiastes earlier in chapter 3, and Ecclesiastes is attributed to Solomon, who is believed to be, of course, or who was the king of Jerusalem, but actually it was likely written later and attributed to Solomon around the year 450 to 200 BC. Now that's a big scope of 250 years. But to give you some context, and I had shared this when we talked about Solomon or about Ecclesiastes before, is that Plato was writing during this time frame. Aristotle was writing during this time frame. And so there was this thing happening in the ancient world around philosophical questioning and thought. In the Christian tradition, we look at this, and there's the author is called the Qohelet. And the Qohelet is translated as teacher or preacher in the Christian tradition. However, in the Jewish tradition, and remember this is originally a Jewish text, it is translated as assembler or leader of the assembly or the one who brings the people together. The Qohelet is gathering together a group and they're circling around this one idea. What does it all mean? What is the purpose of life? In Ecclesiastes, in this particular scripture, we have a statement about the nature of humanity, that we were created to ponder big questions, that God has set eternity on the hearts of all people. This ability to question the bigger things, to look at the sky and ask about that comet and what does it mean for me, or to look at the lake and think, How long has this water been here, and how many people have fished from its edges? And what about the trees and the birds and the fish that have called this place home for centuries? God has set the eternity on the hearts of all people. We might ask these kinds of questions. There's also an observation that from the Qoheleth that says, the best thing about life is really at the end of the day, that people find joy in their work and satisfaction in their routine. That there's nothing new under the sun. That the things that are coming up ahead of us are the things that have come around behind us. That the story of humanity, the landscape might change, the technology might change, the nations might change, the faces might change. But the story of humanity is cyclical and perpetual. And the things that we do today are related to the things that people have done for generations and will do for generations. And because this is the story of humanity, let us find satisfaction and joy in this moment, in this place, at this time, being fully present. In this scripture, there's also an acknowledgement of the evil in the world, that hard things, injustices continue to happen, that this is part of the narrative of the human story. But there's also a sense that there's justice in the human story, and just because things are cyclical and keep happening and it feels like maybe there's no end to the injustice, God continues to be present in the midst of all of it. And that there is this sense of divine justice, that God has something bigger at work and at play, and the places where we see injustice, eventually there it refers to God's judgment. But I want to offer, I think because of the way the scripture sits in the middle of these big existential questions, God's judgment relates to the contentment in our spirit and in our very souls. There's also a sense in this scripture of, it reminds me of actually of Walt Whitman, of Leaves of Grass. One of the great American poems, this idea that we are as humans, as people, as part of creation, connected to all parts of creation through our organic composition. And this idea of what comes next or what is out there beyond this life and on the other side of eternity, although it is a mystery, there is something beautiful about being present in the world as we find it. So the author, the Qoheleth, encourages the assembly to turn their attention to finding satisfaction in the day, be present in the day, to find joy in it. Because the work directly in front of us is the only work we're guaranteed. And by work, I mean the toil, the daily activities, the routine, the beauty, and the mundane. Because we don't know what tomorrow will bring. Be present in this day. And we've been going through some things, right? This is particularly poignant because people are asking these kinds of questions. What does it all mean in terms of the pandemic? In terms of civil unrest and equity in our society and in our systems? In terms of personal health struggles and financial struggles? Our scripture today reminds us to take this day and enjoy it, to embrace it, to sit on the dock and listen, to look to the sky and contemplate the comet and the stars and the creation of the solar system and time itself. When our family went to go look for the comet, we had this lovely, profound moment where we all looked up in the sky. We turned onto a gravel road and it was dark out. We turned off the car lights and we looked up and we could see the little smear in the sky just below the Big Dipper. And we got back in the car only to have one of my children say, "I don't feel very well." and then proceed to vomit. Enjoy the moment, because we don't know what's coming next. And there's even beauty in that moment, right? The idea of our entire family stuck in a car together on a dark country road, and one of us being sick, but we're in it together and we're making it through. And we're doing the things that parents do, and cherishing, even though, I mean, it's gross and disgusting and nobody enjoys that experience. But I'm very aware that these days pass. And that the work of this stage of life, of caring for kids and caring and worrying about school and what comes next for my kids, and all of those questions that many of you are holding, or maybe your grandkids are holding, might feel mundane and routine and maybe even bothersome or toilsome, but enjoy the moment while we have it, because it's not guaranteed to last. To sit on the dock and watch the water, the tide roll away. Somewhere in the middle of being on a country road and swatting mosquitoes to see a smear in the sky, and cleaning up vomit in the car as we try to get home as fast as we possibly can safely. Somewhere in the middle of that, you find yourself in a car with people you love all going in the same direction. And it calls us and reminds us to work for the good of every corner of this planet, so that the generations to come, the next time Comet Neowise comes around, people will be able to enjoy it in the moment. It is the beauty of the star-filled sky and the family-filled vehicle. And it all comes together as we reflect on God's call in our lives to find beauty in all things in their time. To know satisfaction in the mundane and the awesome. To take a moment to sit and enjoy the day. May it be so. And now I invite you to receive the benediction. Please remember to mark your calendars for August 18th at 7 p.m. for our all-church conference. This is a church business meeting where we get together to vote on next year's lay leadership nominees, as well as we'll be talking about a restructure of our church governance or leadership structure. So please check your calendars and mark that down. It'll be by Zoom, and information is coming out through email. Receive now the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you his peace, both now and forever. Amen. Amen. Go in peace.